tuned in to hear LaLa speak. She talking about what's right in the world and what goes wrong to make your spirit unfurl. Now that's
Speakx. Take your glasses, let them hear what you think. To the thirsty, let your words be a drink. LaLa, speak someone with the voice of community. Lend your gifts to help restore unity. LaLa, speak to the masses, let them hear what you think. To the thirsty, let your words be a drink. LaLa, speak someone with the voice of community. Lend your gifts to help restore unity.
Every first Monday at 9 p.m.
Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. And even if I get frustrated and I don't want to talk to the Lord, you know what? He still speaks. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak. She talking about what's right in the world and what goes wrong to make your spirit unfurl. Now that's deep. Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak.
I am a life coach. I am a motivational speaker. I am a wife and a mother and a career woman. I'm all those things. Why? Because I can.
Hold up.
LaLa Speakx is about owning who you are. LaLa Speakx is about loving who you are. LaLa Speakx is about embracing who you are and allowing all those things to move you forward towards action.
LaLa.
Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. And even if I get frustrated and I don't want to talk to the Lord, you know what? He still speaks. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak. She talking about what's right in the world and what goes wrong to make your spirit unfurl.
Hold up.
Now that's
Speakx. Take the glasses, let them hear what you think. To the thirsty, let your words be a drink. LaLa, speak someone with the voice of community. Lend your gifts to help restore unity. LaLa, speak to the masses, let them hear what you think. To the thirsty, let your words be a drink. LaLa, speak someone with the voice of community. Lend your gifts to help restore unity.
Every first Monday at 9 p.m.
Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. And even if I get frustrated and I don't want to talk to the Lord, you know what? He still speaks. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak. She talking about what's right in the world and what goes wrong to make your spirit unfurl.
Hold up.
Now that's deep. Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak.
I am a life coach. I am a motivational speaker. I am a wife and a mother and a career woman. I'm all those things. Why? Because I can.
Hold up.
LaLa Speakx is about owning who you are. LaLa Speakx is about love.
What's going on? What's going on? Good evening, everyone. Good evening, good evening, good evening. Welcome to another First Mondays with LaLa. You know what? We've been on this topic for, this is our third show, Healthy Sexuality. The first two shows, we had two panels, four gentlemen on each panel, some married, some single, talking about a plethora of issues that came in to LaLaSpeaks.com. And so tonight, because I heard a whole uproar, there was a whole lot of people talking about why, when you gonna have the females on, when we gonna do the female show, when we gonna do the wives show, when are we gonna be able to hear the perspective of the women as it relates to infidelity, as it relates to sexless marriages. Like, why are marriages sexless? Why does it seem like there is talk of women not wanting any more sex? What's really going on, right? So I said, all right, cool. So I changed my programming. This evening's show was supposed to be about something totally different. And so I changed the programming to accommodate the requests. And so tonight, we have a panel of four wives. They have agreed to come on the show. And we're going to talk about some of the questions that that we had for the men's show. Both shows. We're going to talk about that. And we're going to have a good time. We're going to try to open up the phone lines. I promise you this time, we're going to try. The last time, we did not... We were not successful because the conversation was so good in studio that we weren't able to open the phone line. So tonight we're going to try. But before we get into the women, there were some follow-up questions that we had from the men's show. And so I did not want to leave those questions unanswered. So what I decided to do was I decided to bring back two of the guys that seemed to be the favorites from the panels, and just to talk about some of the questions that that came in as a result of their show. So this evening, I have with me Ayinde, you may remember him, and I have with me Rufus. And so before we get into the female part of this show, from the female perspective, from the wives' perspective, we're going to talk to Rufus and Ayinde. I've given them each one question because we're giving them 10 minutes on the show, and then we're opening it up to the women. All right? Are we good with that? So we have follow-up questions. So again, if you have any questions as it relates to this show tonight, we do have a chat room that is live and bumping at us, and they're already there. They're already in the chat room. I can't pay attention to the chat room myself, but the people are already in the chat room. We have a few individuals, some who are even on the panel this evening. I'm going to introduce them in a minute, but I am excited about tonight because we have waited for this show with the wives, and the energy is up, and so we're going to do it, all right? But before we get to the wives, I'm going to kick it off with Ayinde. I gave him this question, and I gave him this question this evening because I wanted to hear his thoughts on it, but we had a follow-up question that came in. Ayinde, are you on? Good evening.
Good evening. How are you?
I am wonderful. Let me turn you up. Can you speak again? Good evening.
Good evening.
All right. How are you? I'm good. Okay. So the question that we had for you, Ayinde, was why does it seem like a lot of black men are adverse to marrying women with children from previous relationships? It seems hypocritical to me, since so many of our men were raised by grandmothers, aunts, etc., who took them in and treated them like part of the family. What do you think about that, Ayinde?
Well, I've dated a few women with children. I had four relationships that I considered marriage with. Each of the women had children, and I can say that the majority of the issues that were developing in each relationship was directly tied to the dynamic of her having children and I didn't. And I was raised by my grandmother. My parents passed, and you know, she did a great job. She passed when I was 15, and you know, she taught me a lot, of course. You know, it was just a lot going on in my life and all of that, and it was a blessing, and I thank God that she raised me. But to compare a man coming in, a man who's interested in a woman, to compare that dynamic with a family member, a grandmother, an aunt, or somebody else that's already that part of that child's bloodline, that's part of that child's family, to compare that dynamic is not the same. It's just not the same.
So what type of issues would pop up as a result of you dating women with children, Ayinde?
Well, one of the main issues was discipline, the way of discipline. You know, I'm not a spanker. You know, I'm not going to pull out the belt and whip you. But me, I'm a very stern, do as I say kind of person. You know, mm-hmm. So if you're going to accept me spending money on the child and taking you out to dinner, and everything is about the child. See, the child is an expense. You know, I take you out to dinner, the child won't have done it, you know. Then once you start getting close, and two of the relationships I was in, I was helping with child care. I was helping with picking up the child from school, doing all kind of stuff as a caretaker, a guardian, a father would. But then when it comes time to say something to the child, I'm supposed to be quiet. Because I'm not the father, you know?
Right.
Then you got the father in her ear, he's my son, or, you know, you got arguments with the baby daddy. And then sometimes, you know, the woman's still sleeping with the baby daddy, too.
Ooh.
You know, because he feel he can get a piece.
Ooh.
Because he, you know, that's his child. And so whenever he come over, you know, that dynamic, that happens,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, and this is not only stuff that I experienced, but friends of mine, we talk. And
yeah.
I don't even think it's a black issue. It's not an issue with black men. I think any man that has it's just a hard dynamic. And I would never say that, you know, it doesn't work. But from just friends that I've known over the years and people that I've known over the years, It's just a very challenging dynamic as a man to not have a child and to date a woman with a child. It takes a clear understanding from that woman to really put that man in that role of father. You know,
yeah.
Because you're not just marrying him. You know, you're also, your child is also now have to look at the father as. You have to look at that man as a father. So there has to be a clear respect, a clear conversation. You know, it can work, but it's just a difficult situation when you don't have a child yourself as a man. And, you know, I'm sitting here doing something so-called, you know, raising another child. And I got to deal with your mouth. I got to deal with his mouth. I got to deal with the child talking back and saying something.
Right.
I mean, he didn't come from my loins.
Yeah.
Or the little girl didn't come from my loins. It's just too much of a burden to deal with. For me, it felt, you know, I know some men that have married women who had a child and they didn't have a child. And they, you know, they're happily married still to this day.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah.
Just for me and a lot of guys that I know, it's just a burden that you don't want. There's things I wanted to experience with parenthood at the same time with my wife. I wanted to experience those things together and then
right.
have to deal with certain things.
So you don't see it at all as hypocritical. It's just a matter of whether or not the necessary communication takes place internally to make sure that a possible situation, because it isn't an impossible thing, because like you said, there are people who are successfully doing it, but that situation actually becomes something that is possible due to adequate communication, appropriate boundaries, etc.
Yeah, I mean, there has to be appropriate boundaries. There has to be respect. I mean, come on, you can't have a man being father, picking you up, doing all those things, doing for the child. But then you can't say nothing to the child.
Right.
You know, in that dynamic. Well, you got family members that have something to say because
yeah.
he disciplined the child, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, it's not hypocritical at all because, again, you know, like myself, I have a niece and nephew. And my sister, you know, she had a child. And the father, you know, unfortunately, is not around like he should. But I stepped in, you know, to kind of, you know, to help out and, you know, just to be there to make sure the children were taken care of and make sure my sister, you know, had a good head on her shoulders. And I mean, it was hard, you know, she, you know, was in love and, you know, things happened. She got two kids.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's a hard situation. But it's not hypocritical because my niece and my nephew are my niece and my nephew. They're
right.
my blood.
Right.
They part of me. They always want to look up to me. I'm going to have to see them all the rest of my life.
Yeah.
You know, so
yeah.
I'm not answering to them if I didn't step in, why I didn't step in, or, you know, why I wasn't around. But a man coming in, just because a man was raised by his family member, it's not hypocritical if he says, I want to date a woman without kids.
Right.
That's his choice.
That's just his choice. Right. Right. Okay. Are you
really?
I appreciate your time with us this evening. Thank you so much for coming and making, giving an answer to that question from our viewer. I hope she was listening, and I hope this gave her the answer that she needed. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
All right.
Have a good evening.
You too. All right, so up next we have Rufus, who was on one of our shows as well. You may remember him. You probably do remember him. Rufus, are you there?
I am here, Lenny. How you doing?
I am wonderful. I am wonderful. So the question I have for you, the follow-up question that I have for you is, there seems to be quite a few women who date for several years without the promise of a ring. Personally, I do not believe it takes 10 years to figure out whether the person is the one or not. What specific factors weigh heavily in a man's decision to pop the question, and what specific factors can delay the process? Go ahead, Rufus. I'm going to let you have it.
Okay. All right. Now, let me say this. For coming from a man who dated my wife for 7 years, no, it does not take 10 years to figure out whether or not that woman is marriage material. Normally, it takes, I would honestly say that at about the second year, you know whether or not that woman is wife material. That takes a little time to work out all the bugs, once your relationship gets real, and things of that nature, for you to determine whether or not that woman is wife material. Because for the most part, you're pretending for a long period of time for that first year and a half.
Right.
Now, I want to say this, you know, to the women out there, and to the women out there who started off their relationships as the side chick or the one night stand, I'm going to say that you might want to chalk that up as a loss if you've been dating this man for a number of years and he hasn't popped the question on you.
Now, why is that? Why is that?
And I'm about to say that. One of the main questions I always ask myself before I started dating a woman, trying to determine whether or not she was wife material, I'd ask two simple questions. One, will she be a good wife to me? And two, if my daughter grew up to be exactly like she is right now, would I be proud of that?
Wow.
Simply put, is she worthy to raise my daughters?
Wow.
And if you have a character flaw that is so pronounced, like you were a former stripper or something to that effect, you are not worthy, in my opinion, to be my wife.
Hey, now.
To raise my daughter, because if my daughter grew up to be you, I would not be proud of that moment. Okay. I would not be happy at that moment.
Keep it real.
So I think, you know, those women, if you fall into that category, I apologize for what I just said, but that's the reality of your situation. In all likelihood, you are not the woman who's going to get you're not the woman who's going to get married to that man that you're chasing. Because he probably calls you on Wednesday most of the time, because his Monday chick is the woman that he really loves, and he calls you on Wednesday.
So
you probably need to let that go. Let that one go and move on with your life, because there's somebody else out there where you can reestablish yourself as a woman of character if you've changed. Because a lot of their women have changed. They've done things in their life. But if you met that man at a point in time in your life where you were conducting yourself in a way that is not reflective of the woman that you would want your child, your daughter to grow up to be, in all likelihood, he's probably not going to put you in that wife category if he is a man of character.
Okay, so the guys that roll through and just kind of look at somebody to buy time with, they looking for a particular character as well? Are they looking for the easy type?
Correct. I mean, exactly. There are women out there that no man wants to be alone. I always joke and laugh with my wife all the time. And I say to her, you know, I haven't been single since I was 14 years old. Mm-hmm. I said, so that means is that if she decided to leave me or something happened to her, there's about 3 weeks where my bed's going to be empty. I'm going to go find me somebody. You know what I'm saying? I don't know if that woman's going to be wife material at that time, but I'm not going to sleep alone. So most men don't want to be alone. So they will, if they're not at the time looking for a wife, or even if they are, they're always on the prowl.
Yeah.
So they do look for the easy prey. They will take the low-hanging fruit. You can't be low-hanging fruit.
Yeah.
You have to always present yourself as a woman of character, as a woman of dignity. If you want that man, because that man has to rise up to you. You know, you know, and I've said this to a number of women who dated their men for a long time, that they want to know, how did they get their man to marry them? And I ask them this question. One, has he adjusted to certain characteristics about himself, to suit you, your needs? If he is the exact same man that you met 5 years ago, and he has not changed one bit, chances are you're not going to be his wife.
Wow.
When I met my wife, I had a rule that no woman could call me on Monday night at 9 o'clock because Monday night football was on.
Uh-huh.
Prudence did not have to adhere to that rule.
Okay, now.
She was special.
Okay.
Okay. So,
That's right.
I tell these women, and this is one of the advices that I've given to them all the time, and I say this, and I've said this multiple times to multiple different women. I said, if you want to know if your man loves you, if you want to know if you're the one, because I have, and I'll tell you why I have this story. You have to have a conversation with that brother. If you've been dating, let's say, 3 or 4 years, you're not in your early 20s, like 22, 23 years old, but you're like 28, 29, 30. Y'all been dating 3 or 4 years, and you want to know if he loves you? And y'all have, let's just say, for example, y'all living together. Okay, y'all living together, and you sit down with that man, and you have a conversation with him. You be plain, and make your intentions known, like, look, if you're not willing to marry me, then we need to move on and go on about our business. And see how he reacts to that. And if he doesn't give you the reaction that you want, what you need to do is, and this has happened, and I've told you this advice, and they figure these things out, is that you need to go home, you need to take the day off, let him get up, go to work in the morning, right? Don't let him know you're taking the day off, let him go to work, then you pack all of your stuff and leave.
And roll out.
Okay? All of your stuff, so when he comes home, you are gone.
Yes.
And you will know that if that man loves you, because if he don't call you for 2 days like the girl that left me, okay, because she broke up with me and I didn't call her for 2 days because I was happy because I needed a break. I didn't really like her that much. So, right? If he don't call you for 2 or 3 days, if he ain't calling you asking what's going on, he don't love you. You are not that man. But you have to be willing to accept the fact that you are not that man's one. And move on about your business and pray that God finds a man for you, or have that, or hoping that this brother was preparing you for the man that was waiting for you.
That's right.
And move on.
I hear that. Let me tell you. The chat room is here talking about three men in a truck. Get your stuff and roll out.
And you will know if that man loves you. Because trust me, when my wife, let me tell you something. When me and Prudence, we went through a period of time when we broke up. And I will say this, right?
Mm-hmm.
I had a conversation with my mother. And I said to her, I said, Ma, I did not know that I could love a woman. I could love somebody as much as I love her.
Okay.
I said, that's what I said to her. I said, I am going to go find her. Because I had to go find my woman. Because that was going to be my wife. Because she had become a part of me. And her leaving me hurt more than anything else that I could imagine in my life. So I had to marry her.
Yeah.
Okay. You have to find a man that is willing to move heaven and earth to come find you.
That's right. That's right.
And love you, like, love you to the core of who you are. But you can't have some brother flitting around, because if he is not changing for you, he is not adjusting his personality for you, he does not care that you leave, he don't love you.
That's right.
Like, you are not his wife. He clearly has another woman.
Yeah.
Because if he's treating you that way, he got another woman. All likely he's got another woman.
Yeah.
Trust me.
Yeah, and you know what?
Got another woman.
You make a good point, because a lot of times women feel that they got to make the first move, they got to do this. If a man wants you, you don't have to do that. He's going to find you.
You don't.
He's going to find you.
And he's going to adjust for you. He's going to think about your needs and he's going to think about your needs all the time. He's going to think about what you need, what you want, what he has to do for you. Now, some brothers, they're not as refined as other brothers are, and I understand that. We're all not the same. We're not all as smooth. Some brothers are smoother because they grew up with a father. So they understand how to treat a woman differently than some brothers like me. I didn't grow up with a father. Mm-hmm. But there are things that I had to learn over time on how to treat a woman, because, you know, I didn't necessarily see it to the level of how I treat my wife. My son sees me do it every day.
Right.
But there were things that I did that were important to me that I gave up for her.
Yeah.
That I gave up for her to make sure that she was happy.
Yeah.
And they need to. You need to go out there, make sure. And now I want to say this one other thing too.
Uh-huh.
All women are not wife material. You have to accept that sometimes your calling is somewhere else. And that you being married or chasing this husband is keeping you from your calling. All of you are not meant to be married.
Ooh.
And all of you aren't material. So you need to accept another calling in life and move on and be happy. But don't get confused by things like, I have a college degree, I look good, my sex is great. I have never stayed with a woman because her sex was great. Mm. Now, I've left a woman because the sex was bad, but I have never stayed with a woman because the sex was great. You know, on the fact, if she had some bad character qualities, she had bad qualities, it didn't matter how good the sex was, because I still was leaving.
Yes.
Okay? She has to be a woman of character and dignity and distinction. Okay. Woman that would be proud that my daughter would one day become.
Yes.
That's what she has to be.
Yes. Rufa, you know, I think you just gave me another show. All women are not wife material. We would unpack that all night long. Oh, my goodness. You know what? You know what, Rufus? I'm not going to keep you because you done talked up Putin so much. I think she's waiting for you right now. So I appreciate your time, Rufus. As always, you keep it 100, and that's why I love you, man. I appreciate you. Tell Putin to say, tell Putin to say what's up. You too. Bye.
All right, bye-bye.
Let me tell you something. That's my fam from Atlanta, Rufus himself. Okay, so we're going to have to do that. We're going to have to do that show. The chat room right now, I can't keep up with it. But we're getting ready to go into our panel, the women that we have here this evening with us. And I am going to introduce them one by one. They're going to introduce themselves, tell you a little bit about themselves. And then for the next maybe 45 minutes, we're just going to talk about a lot of the questions that we got. And that we received through LaLaSpeakx.com. So this evening I have with me, I'm going to start off with my dear friend, Miss Kwani. Good evening, Kwani. How are you?
Good evening. All is well here.
Awesome.
How are you?
I am wonderful. I cannot at all complain. Let's tell everybody else about yourself. Let's see who Miss Kwani is and what we're about to get into tonight.
All right. Well, as Ms. Randy said, my name is Kwani. I have been married to my wonderful husband for almost 9 years now. And we have three little children who are the pride and joy of our lives. And they also ensure that we are going to make it to heaven.
Yes.
Because, Yes. Let's see what else. I have a very full life, so, yes.
She said,
I do lots of things.
She said, yes.
Yes. Yeah, we do lots of things over here.
Yes. Yes.
But I wouldn't have it any other way.
Awesome, Kwani. I am so happy that you are with us this evening. I am looking forward to your insight this evening. So thank you so much for joining.
Thank you so much. Oh, it's my pleasure. Happy to be here.
Thank you. Up next, I have Crystal, my good girlfriend from Atlanta, Georgia, Crystal Wilson. Good evening, Crystal. How are you?
Good evening. I'm great. How are you?
I'm good. You know, I have absolutely no complaints. This has been a fun show so far. So I'm grinning already from ear to ear. So I can't wait to get into the questions with you ladies. So tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I'm Crystal, and I'm married. I've been married for going on 17 years. I have two children, one biological and one adopted. And I live in Atlanta, and I can't wait to answer some of these questions. And I love that Rufus put it all on the table.
Yes. Now, we know that's what Rufus was going to do, though.
I was like, he will not disappoint.
Never. Never. Well, Crystal, I am so very thankful that you were here with us this evening. So I'm looking forward to getting into it, all right? Thanks for joining.
No problem.
So up next, we have another good girlfriend of mine, Miss Sheila. Y'all gonna learn about Sheila real quick. This is my girl, Sheila. Good evening, Sheila. How are you?
I'm well. How are you there?
Girl, I am good. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
I am married. It's gonna be 11 years this year in the summer. I have one son. He's only 12. you know, he's up there almost my height, you know, so it's fisticuffs.
Yeah.
You know, I just like to have fun with my family, close out with my girls.
Awesome.
And keep it as honest as possible.
Awesome. Well, Sheila, you know, I am very excited to have you here with us this evening. I'm looking forward to the things that you have to say. So thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, thank you for having me.
All right, hun. All right, up next, last but definitely not least, is Miss Paula. Hey, Paula, good evening.
Good evening.
How are you?
I'm awesome. How are you?
I'm good, girl. I cannot at all complain. Life is great. Life is absolutely great. Thank you so much for agreeing to be with us this evening.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, so tell us a little bit about yourself.
I'm a mother of twin girls. They're 20 going on 21. I'm on my second marriage. I'm a fairly newlywed in my second marriage, and I was married before about 18 years.
Okay.
Then I am an educator and just a girl who likes to talk and share her experiences, and that's basically who I am.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, Paula, you know, I am very excited to have you here with us this evening. I know you have a lot of wisdom that you are willing to share. That's one thing I enjoy about our friendship. So I am definitely glad to be here with you this evening. Thank you so much for joining First Mondays with LaLa. So now...
Absolutely. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. So now this evening, so we have all ladies on the line. We have Miss Paula, Miss Sheila, Miss Crystal, and Miss Kwani. And we have a few questions that we may or may not get through, but hey, we're going to try. We're going to have a good time. We're going to talk real talk. As I always say, this is not a show for the kids. This is not a show for your children. I will make sure that I post that on YouTube when I post this video, that this is not a show for your children. The reason being is because we're talking about healthy sexuality. We're talking about infidelity. We're talking about sexless marriages. We are giving it real conversation this evening so that we can discuss real solution. All right? As I was telling someone the other day, when you don't air your laundry, then it holds you captive. It holds you captive because what someone said, what you resist will persist. So we're putting it all out tonight. We're going to be 100% real to make sure that we help someone through him who may be encountering a particular issue or a particular challenge, right? Life is full of challenge, but we always have the tools to be successful. So let's just do it tonight. Let's get into the conversation. So ladies, thank you so much for joining First Mondays with LaLa. You know, we're going to start off a little light. We have a few questions that can easily turn however they're going to turn, but we're going to start off a little light. So our first question this evening is, are married women threatened by single women with their husbands? I'm going to just let that.
Oh.
I'm going to let it. Y'all go ahead.
this is Sheila. Can I?
Go ahead.
Am I open?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
Okay. So here's my thing. I don't think, for me anyway, I think my husband and I have a solid relationship, and so I'm not threatened by single women. My husband and I actually hang out. Most of my friends, a large part of them are single, and we all hang out. My friends can come to my house, you know, because if I consider you a friend, I consider you family. With that being said, I am very guarded when it comes to my family. Mm-hmm. Right? So, my husband and I have a relationship where, as a matter of fact, some woman came up to me yesterday and she touched me in an inappropriate way. And we were at an open church function, so I couldn't carry on the way I wanted to.
Oh!
So, I let it be, and then I sent him a text today. Don't you let this happen ever again. I need you to check her if she, you know, if anybody tries to touch you like that again. And he was like, refused. You know, I think that, and this was a married woman, was not a single woman. So I think that it's not so much of who is a single, if it's a single or married woman, it's just I guard my family. And I'm the person who tells my husband, okay, you know, that doesn't look appropriate. You might want to check that out next time. Just keep your eyes open. And he may say the same thing to me.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I will say that there are a few people in the single or single women and married women that are inappropriate with married men. And there are some married men or single men that are inappropriate with the other, you know, female situation.
Uh-huh.
So I think
women need to stop kind of pigeonhole whether or not a married woman is concerned about them or not, right? And if they all have the conversation, but I don't think that should be completely true.
Right. I hear you. I totally agree, and I totally hear you. Anyone else?
This is Crystal. To be quite honest, I've never have had the experience where I felt threatened in any way, married, non-married. Me and my husband were, you know, we're jokesters. We like to hang out. We're friendly. I just feel like if a guy is going to accept the inappropriate behavior, then he's going to accept my backlash, because I will come with it.
Right.
I don't care what arena we're at. The disrespect will never happen openly to where if you know me, you know that I will speak up.
Yeah.
As far as openly general women being threatened, I mean, and not amongst the girls or the young women I'm associated with, there's just enough strength in us to know our spouse. We know them. We've been with them I've been with my husband for 24 years.
Yeah.
I know what he likes. I know if he likes another person. You know, I know if he likes another woman walking by. I will even look at him and go, oh, you like that? But to be quite honest, the threatened mentality isn't a mentality that I, per se, have ever experienced as a married woman. I have a best friend who's single. And she has said, when she goes out with her married friends, and she chooses not to very often, but she said she always feels like all the women are giving her the side eye.
Wow.
Ooh. And I would always say, how would you know? You're supposed to be having fun. But she says it's the vibe that married women give to single women.
Wow.
I'm just not that person. I'm very open with any and everyone. If you step over the line, no matter if you're married or single, I will address it. My husband's not so keen to know when people are doing something that's blatantly disrespectful. I always remind him. I don't even get home. I say it right there, buddy. This chick right here, let's go talk to her together. Or this man right here, he's kissing me on the side of the cheek, but close to my lips. Let's go address this.
Yeah.
But my best friend is single, and she has told me the reason why she won't hang out with a lot of my friends, because my friends are married, is because the women are giving her the side eye.
Wow.
So, my perspective is, I'm not threatened. But I do know that that is a saying amongst the single women. And most of my married women friends don't seem to have that problem. They don't digest it as much as the single women feel that it's a problem.
Right. And I was about to say the same thing. A lot of my married friends, we're not thinking about that. You know, if we ever hear anything like that, honestly, for me, if I ever hear anything that a married woman is threatened by a single woman, I've heard it from guys. I really have never, the women that I hang with, we're not thinking like that. We're not talking like that. The single women, we hang together with married women and there's no issue, you know? So it's very interesting that we have different takes on that. Paula, were you going to say something?
Yeah, I actually was. When I first got divorced, and this may be the difference for how this has transpired, at least in the church. I was married 18 years, and then when I got divorced, many people didn't know I was divorced because I still was on the praise and worship team. My ex-husband, he was at the same church that I was in. So it wasn't like you had the big fallout when we were, you know, had the big thing. Right. None of that ever happened.
Right.
But as people got to know that I was divorced, I was at a friend's house for dinner, and I could tell that a few women were looking like, oh, you know, she ain't a husband no more.
Oh.
And I didn't recognize it until I saw one particular lady who goes to Decatur Church. At the time, I lived in Atlanta. She just kind of looked at me kind of oddly. So I walked up to the table, and I asked somebody, the host husband, who I've known his wife since I was 11 or 12 years old. I said, oh, can you pass me something on the table? I think it was cake or something. And I said, oh, and by the way, I don't want your husband. I just got rid of mine. And don't want your husband, so y'all can keep him. I don't want the one I had. I definitely don't want yours. So y'all can still keep your eyes, you know. And that's, they all fell out laughing.
Yeah.
But that opened the conversation for them
right.
to ask me questions. And since that time, I think people just are uneasy because they don't know.
Right.
I'm not sure if I totally believe it's about, oh, you know, she want my husband. I think they just don't know what to say to you. And when they're single and you're newly single, because I had been single since I was 22. I got married at 23. But I wasn't going to sit in a room and be uncomfortable. So if y'all want to be uncomfortable, y'all go right ahead.
Yeah.
I'm going to eat my cake.
Right.
So, you know, once you address it from that standpoint, and I addressed it with them right there in front of everybody, and they laugh, and then, you know, a couple guys asked me, well, what are you doing now? Are you dating? And, you know, we had an additional conversation outside of that. But, again, it's all in how you present it, and it's all in how you carry yourself.
Yeah.
If some women carry themselves and they feel like they're uncomfortable, then you shouldn't be there.
Yeah.
Simple as that. If it's uncomfortable, and I have girlfriends that say, oh, I don't hang out with a bunch of married folks. Well, that's your choice.
Right.
But it's not because, you know, I'm afraid that you're going to make a run for Riddell. Riddell know what Paula would do.
Yeah.
So it's not about that. So I think sometimes we get it in our heads, and that may not be the case for every situation. So that's my take on that.
And you know what I find very interesting and what I totally agree with, Paula, and it actually is the whole purpose for this show, is when you give airtime to something, then you can't act like as if though it's holding you back. You can't act like it's no longer the elephant in the room. So what you did by saying, I want your husband, because I just got rid of mine, tells them, it really kind of relieves the pressure in the room. And you can have a conversation now, because you've already said, listen, it ain't even about that. And I ain't even thinking about that. So if you think I'm thinking about that, you need to think something else, you know? And I really think that that's a great way to really address and to really kill a lot of the assumptions that people have when they think one thing and they think another thing, is because you haven't talked about it and you don't even have the gall or the guts to even approach it. So before you can even do that, you know, first you got to realize and be like, okay, well, this is where I am with it. Where are you with it? And let's see if we can meet somewhere in the middle, you know?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Quan, did you have something or ouch?
No, I just want to piggyback on what some of the other ladies have been saying. I totally agree with the fact that for myself as a married woman, I don't even think along those lines.
Yeah.
So when mm-hmm. I see other women, whether you be single or married, you know, my first instinct is not to say, oh, they're after my husband, or oh, they want my husband, or oh, I'm threatened by them in any fashion.
Right.
So I think it may be a combination of maybe there's another issue going on, and
right.
maybe the first thing that they can think of is, oh, she must be threatened by me. Well, maybe I just don't like you as a person. Not necessarily, I'm, you know, thinking that you're threatened by you being around my husband.
Right.
So there are other issues that may be underlying there.
How about that?
That it's just easy to put it on, oh, she don't like me because I'm single. So, again, you know, going back to, you know, opening up dialogue and having those conversations, let's get to the heart of the issue.
Yeah.
You know, let's not, put a blanket over something and assume it's one thing when it's not.
So, yeah. Yeah.
That's important.
Totally.
Landy.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes. I'm here.
Oh.
Yeah.
So, like Connie was just saying, let's keep it all the way line. There are just some women you don't want in your space.
True.
There are some women you don't want in your house. There are some women you have an apartment, you don't want them there. And like Connie said, it may not have anything to do with them being around your husband. But that's on us as well as women to keep our, like, open up our mouth and say why.
Yes.
You know, the communication is, if there's somebody that I'm not vibing, why is it a wrong issue to be like, you know, somebody said, oh, can I bring so-and-so? I'm going to be keeping 100. somebody called my husband one day, was like, oh, your wife is having surgery. I'm coming over. Can I bring so-and-so? My husband was like, you can't bring her here. My husband was like, that's not a good idea.
Yeah.
Not because I think she like my husband or she want to be, you know, whatever. He already know that, yeah, I don't vibe her.
Right.
Mm-hmm. She could think whatever she want to think.
Right.
If she ever asked me, I'll tell her why.
Yeah.
But...
I think that's fair. I think the fact that you don't vibe with everybody, and that's okay. We ain't got to vibe with everybody. The only thing the Bible asks us to do is love one another. We ain't got to vibe with everybody. So I think it's okay once you know where you are with somebody. It may not be that this particular issue, what you're thinking, it may not even be that. It may be like you just said, Sheila, I don't want you in my space, and I'm okay with that. And it's my prerogative to say that, especially if I don't want you in my house. If I don't want you in my house, you best believe don't bring nobody if I don't want you here.
Landy.
Yes.
Landy, this is Crystal. I wanted to say something real quick.
Yeah.
For me, my husband is really, really involved in church. And, I mean, he holds all these little whatever positions,
yes.
Whatever. He gets voted to do whatever. We're that 20% working couple.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So one day, it's not even the young single women. It's the old single women. One lady came up to me and said, don't you like him when he's in that suit? I said, I sure do. She said, I wonder if he's married. I said, I believe he is.
Oh.
And then she said, well, how do you know? And I showed her. I was like, because I'm married to him. She goes, oh, I thought he was your brother.
Oh.
I was like, do we sit together like brothers? I mean, we rarely sit together. But when we sit together, we're sitting close.
Right.
But the lady was so innocent. So now when he sees her and he's deaconing and he has to go to her row to get that money, he'd be like, oh, my Lord, this old woman is trying to push up on me right up at the church. I get a kick off of it. So I'm personally laughing while he's feeling a little uncomfortable. So I think these single women may be thinking they're doing themselves justice by being aggressive. Some men don't like aggressive women.
Yeah.
Some men run from aggressive women.
Right.
So, I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. That's hilarious. Okay, so let's move on to the next question. We're doing okay on time. Let's move on to the next question. The question is it possible for men and women to be friends? This is a question from the last show. The guys gave their opinion on it. And
No.
You already answered the question. Because this guy...
I'm sorry, this is Crystal again.
Go ahead.
I mean, are you talking about, like, best friends? Because I read it as the guy and the women are best friends.
Yeah, so it says, her best friend is another guy, and no, he's not gay. I have met him a few times, but they speak often, and they both know loads about each other's personal lives. I'm not sure how I feel about it. And if I remember this question, this came in from someone who was about to be married to this woman who had issues with her male best friend.
Okay, well, I have talked to so many guys. I'm not saying I'm best friends with them. Most of the guys I'm friends with, it's due to association through my husband, or we just like going, you know, whenever we're invited to parties, you know, we socialize with people. I haven't been a best friend to a male before because... based on my brothers, based on my husband, based on that Rufus crew, we have discussed this in detail. And most of them say a man can have a platonic relationship without putting a woman in a few categories. And a BFF isn't a real category because they have at least in their mind thought, is this somebody I could possibly sleep with?
Yeah.
Is this a person who is just straight up crazy, because after 30, they believe most women get crazy. or if this is a buddy friend zone, and if that's the case, it's because they're purely unattracted to the person.
Yeah.
So when a woman and a man are considered too close for comfort and they know each other's secrets, it could lead to something that may be inappropriate. And if you're willing to take that chance, then so be it. But there has to be some boundaries if you're going to accept the opposite sex as your best friend.
Yeah.
And you have to make sure you know what category you fit in.
Yeah.
That category, are you buddy friend zone because there's no attraction? Are you, does the person like the opposite sex and not liking you? Of course, it says not gay, but does a guy put you in a crazy category?
Oh.
Or does he mind sleeping with you and he's just waiting for you to get soft so he can make that move?
Wow.
Landon?
Yeah.
This is Sheila.
Yeah.
So here's my thing. I was on the show when this question came up the last time, and I was going off in the chat room because I had a bunch of questions. Because although I completely agree with the boundary situation in terms of a male and female relationship, when you get in a relationship, you have to set boundaries. However, I would venture to ask, did he have this conversation with her from the jump? Right?
Mm-hmm.
Because when you start a relationship with somebody, I have friends who had male friends. Now, my male friends fell off once I moved in with my husband, so it was a wrap for them. They were not trying to holler at me no more.
Yeah.
So I figured that they have me in that category, which was, you know, there was a possibility. Right?
Yeah.
And then when me and Daniel got together, it was no longer a possibility. So that was the end of Sheila and possibly them.
Right.
Now, I have friends, female friends, who actually have male friends they grew up with, like neighbors, and nothing ever happened. It was strictly platonic, and I became friends with their male friends. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Not in terms of where we're on the phone talking, but we all hanging out together and stuff like that. Now, my friend, when got in a relationship with her guy, the guy had a conversation with her. I was like, okay, look, I know you and so-and-so are really close, but how does that affect our relationship?
Right.
So I was venture to ask, did he have that conversation with her? You can't now want to get married and think, oh, well, you know, what's up with your homie? Y'all know too much. He on the phone with you late at night. Like, y'all didn't have this discussion a long time ago?
Right.
Like, don't be recording, or when you're in a relationship and you're developing a relationship and a communication and a friendship with the person you think you're going to marry, you have these conversations.
Right.
So he now want to come back 2 years later whenever he decides to propose to her. You cannot put stipulations into the relationship at the last hour.
Right.
You have to say, okay, now you can probably slowly have that conversation, but you should have had that a long time ago.
Yeah.
And now you want to make some place where she's comfortable because you allowed her to get comfortable, and now you want to make her have demands on her. You can lose her.
Yeah. Yeah, no, he needed to have that conversation from jump if he didn't have that conversation. Yeah, he needed to have from jump.
Yes.
Anyone else on this one? Go ahead.
This is Paula.
Yeah.
I have a very unique situation, I guess, because I've always had more male friends than female friends. Mm-hmm. And so when Riddell and I got married, my three best buddies were men.
Okay.
My best friend is a girl,
mm-hmm.
A woman I've known since I first grade. But my three best friends that I speak to every day, we've had an ongoing text for probably 10 years.
Wow.
But when I married him, he married them too.
Ah.
And Riddell loves my male friends. All three of them are pastors, two of them are single, one's married. I love his wife. She called me, his birthday's this week, to ask me and Riddell to do a video for his birthday.
Oh.
We did it. When my grandmother died last year, he came to the funeral. She wanted to come and she couldn't come because she had some other events. I think the problem is when you don't have communication and expectation.
Mm-hmm.
I was very clear about what my husband and what their relationship is. Now, I don't tell my best guy friends my business. We talk about general life stuff. Each one of us has children, so we talk about that. We talk about church stuff and their church stuff. And the conversation, if it gets personal, usually it's a one-on-one conversation, not a three-way conversation.
Right.
So, but Riddell understood that, and he had to accept that I love each one of them, and that's how it is.
Yeah.
And Riddell now loves them, and he calls them my boyfriend, jokingly.
Uh-huh.
He's like, how your boyfriend is doing today? Oh, they're fine. So-and-so's here. And they travel, and they preach, and so, you know, they check in and say, hey, because I'm like a mother.
Yeah.
It's not like a girlfriend.
Yeah.
I'm like the mother. I'm like, hey, make sure you let me know when you get home. You know, text me, let me know you got back to New York or wherever it is they're going.
Yeah.
So I think it depends on the situation.
Yeah.
And to me, they're like my brothers. They're not boyfriends. Like, you know, have we went out together? They've taken me out when I got divorced. They're like, okay, come on, we're gonna get you going. We're going to take you out and get you eating. We don't want you to sit at home being bored. They was my support system.
Yeah.
So the circumstances for me were a little bit different than them trying to hit on me.
Yeah.
They're my brothers.
Yeah.
They love Riddell just like they love me. So it just depends on the circumstances and how it's framed. And if you're not honest in communicating with in the very beginning, you can't be shady and say, oh, yeah, by the way, I text him every day. And then, he looks at your phone and he sees you texting him more than you texting him. That's not cool.
Yeah.
Communication up front and expectations have to be laid out so that there's no misunderstanding and there's no those shadiness going on. And it's not like their wives don't know. I mean, my friend, his wife knows who I am, and she knows that I talk to him, and she knows that he helps me with certain things. That's not a secret.
Yeah.
It's all up front, and we all love each other. But it has to be a matter of communication.
Yeah.
And you have to have boundaries. Now, I don't know what goes on in their marriage. If he calls and talks to me about it, I would keep it to myself.
Yeah.
But I've learned that if you lay it out correctly, it will always be correctly. You lay it out shady, it's gonna always be shady.
It's gonna be shady.
And you can't start wrong except right to come right to come from it. If it starts out wrong, it's gonna continue to be wrong.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the one big thing that you mentioned, Paula, is the fact that even in your friendships with these three gentlemen, you have established boundaries so you can maintain a crystal clear relationship with them. And I think that
right. The
boundaries, the existence of boundaries and honesty, because you wide up open, you know, with your husband about, I talk here, we talked about this, we whatever, you know, and he understands. And you have established boundaries. I think that is key. That is definitely key. I'm noticing that we have a caller in. I haven't really opened the lines yet, but if you want to call in, I'll go ahead and give y'all the number now, you know, because I already have someone who's sitting there. If you want to call in, you can dial the number 215-383-5846. If you have a question, press 1, and then I will know that you want to speak, okay? If you don't press 1, I'm just going to see a number sitting there, and I'm not going to click on you. But if you have a question, press 1 after you dial 215-383-5846 so we can talk, okay? Did anyone have any other feedback on this particular question of male-female friendships?
Yeah, Landy, this is Connie. So I just have to jump in and say this. So the question seemed to me as if it was not the typical type of platonic relationship. So best friend to me implies a certain level of intimacy, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so this question is saying these two people know so much about each other's lives and backgrounds, but at some point they are kind of involved, and it implies that level of intimacy and knowing that person on a particular level.
Yeah.
So what Paula was describing, I don't think really fits this scenario, because she's not just having this intimate one-on-one relationship with these men. Her husband knows who they are.
Yeah.
You know, one of the person, their wives knows who she is. So there's like some established boundaries that are kind of automatically in there,
yeah.
As opposed to having a best friend where your husband or your wife or whoever your significant other doesn't know who this person is or doesn't have a relationship with them.
Yeah.
And that's the problem. So for me as a married woman, it's absolutely not going to happen that I have a male best friend outside of my husband.
Right.
Because who should I be going to with my heartaches? Who should I be going
right.
to with, you know, all the concerns and cares and fears of my life? It should
right.
not be someone outside
right.
of this covenant that I have with my husband.
Right.
And the same
right.
thing. And, you know, I asked him, I said, babe, what do you think about this scenario, whatever? He was like, oh, absolutely not.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is a man. And I've heard it time and time again from other men. This is not... this type of best friend that you are on this intimate level with,
it ain't happening. It's either, and so these are my husband's words. He said, it's either that they were trying to be with this person and it didn't happen, or they honestly have no attraction to this person, but not that they may not have even tried to do something with this person. But and so that, to me, it implies that for men to have this type of relationship on that intimate level, that there's some type of attraction, whether it be physical, whether it be psychological, you know, there's some emotional connection that's happening with these two people in order for them to claim, this is my best friend. You don't just go out on the street corner and pick up some dude off the street and say, oh, this is my best friend.
Right.
No, you know them on an intimate level. And that's where the danger happens.
Right.
The only person that you should have that type of relationship with is the person that you have made a covenant, you know, relationship with before that. And, I mean, listen, that if you go outside of that, that's the problem.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we
have. That's where your boundary is. Your safety and your boundary is inside your marriage.
Yes.
So if you go outside of that, then what's really going on?
Yes.
So this is Sheila.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to say again, I know we're all married women on the call, and we're speaking from a married point of view, but the question is coming from a single person's point of view. And as I was saying before, we have to look at it as in a different function. The relationship function completely different. He met her with a male friend, and he did not communicate with her his intention. That's what it seems like to me. So now he has these great intentions, but now he doesn't know how he should feel.
Mm.
Now, how he should feel is reflective. He should be reflecting on the type of relationship he wants with this woman. He needs to communicate with her how he feels. He needs to tell her what his intentions are so that she can evaluate how the relationship she has with her male friend can and will affect the relationship she wants or will have with this gentleman.
Right.
So back to communication. As a single man, he can't command anything from her. He just needs to communicate his intentions with her. And so from a female point of view, when, you know, most of you guys that know me know that I was interested in my husband when I met him. But he made his intentions clear from day one, from jump.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to respect his intentions. Plus, he followed me everywhere I went, right?
Right.
And so I knew what he wanted from me.
Mm-hmm.
And it took me time to get where he was. But I knew that he had these ideas of what we can be together.
Yeah.
So if he opens up to her and tells her what his intentions are and how he feels about the relationship, not commanding anything from her, but how he feels about the relationship that he would like for her and him to have, she may say, okay, I get the boundary. I get how our relationship can affect our future.
Yeah.
And maybe she would understand that. But again, you have to start from jump. After 3 months or 6 months of dating, he should have started having this conversation with her, letting her know, okay, I think that we're growing, and please, let's talk about the things that I do that you don't like and the things that you have that, you know, may affect us. And that's not how they should have started. Foundation is key.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, Sheila, can I say something?
Mm-hmm.
This is Krista. Take yourself back when you were single and you were just dating someone. You don't know if you're going to marry that person. You're dating that person. You need to think that, huh? You would think that when I'm dating someone, I'm not going to just drop those relationships that I have prior to that person coming in. So you don't ask those uncomfortable questions when you're first dating. But if you're going to court someone, then, you know, those, I don't want to say demands, but those questionable relationships that you had when you were single, you're not going to bring them into the relationship a full thrust.
LaLa Speakx is about embracing.
You're not going to make your spouse or your potential spouse feel uncomfortable about them. It's either you love your spouse and you're willing to be the person that knows that this may be an uncomfortable subject for yourself, or you can just let your friends know, that BFF
right.
isn't our title anymore. We're good friends, but you're not going to know all of my secrets, my ins, my outs, or
right.
whatever. And most people, when they realize you're married, I mean, even my best friend, there's a step back that they take because they respect your relationship.
Right.
And if the husband has to, or boyfriend or fiance has to have a conversation and she's not getting it already, then I don't think she recognizes how it makes that person feel, and she needs to reevaluate, is the friendship that important that she's making her partner
for? LaLa Speakx is about owning who you are.
And I'm not saying it to say that the person could take 2 years, 3 years. The time doesn't matter. It's the fact that if you put your spouse in a situation or your potential spouse in a situation to where they are questioning that commitment you have over there, then something isn't happening to where that communication is well thought out. And if he has to guess, most men tend to always think, even when they don't have an issue with the brother, when they know that you are constantly in their spouse's or girlfriend's face, they're thinking those categories. Mm-hmm. Is he trying to sleep with my lady? Is he just trying to make a move? Does she, you know, it's a lot. According to my husband and his friends and my brother, they are saying that women know when they are putting a brother in an uncomfortable situation. We are so intellectual women, and we know if it's going to bother the person we're dating.
Yeah.
And that person needs to be honest with herself and saying, is the relationship that important?
Yeah.
I think that, I'm sorry, was it Paula?
That was Crystal.
Oh, it was Crystal. So I think we're both speaking apples here. I think what your first part of your statement is basically what I was saying. Until the relationship starts to grow and the conversation happens, however it may happen, it may happen as a joke, it may happen as him stating his claim or stating how he feels about her, and then, of course, what you're going into is something else. So she may not want that type of relationship with him, but again, it all boils down to a conversation.
Yeah.
Right.
I definitely agree.
Yeah, always lead to bad things.
Yeah.
One, she can't assume he's okay with her relationship with her friend, and she can't assume that because they're expecting each other and they're loving on each other that she's going to get what he's thinking.
Right.
So both have to have a conversation.
Yeah, the communication. Absolutely. Communication needs to take place, for sure. I want to reiterate the number, 215-383-5846. I had two people holding on. I'm sorry. We were in the middle of that conversation. You guys dropped off. I think you were holding on too long. But if you guys want to talk, I'm opening the lines now. We're going to go to another question, but I'm opening the lines now. And if you want to speak after you dial 215-383-5846, go ahead and press 1, and I will get to you. I'm seeing you. I will get to you, but I won't break the conversation until we move through the next question. So we're going to move to the next question, and this question may take us a minute, but I think we're warm now. So let's see what goes on with this question. All right. I'm a 32-year-old male engaged to be married in the next few months, and I am confused on whether or not I should be happy to be getting married. I am hearing multiple differing opinions on marriage, and it honestly doesn't seem like something I should have even pursued. The biggest complaint I hear from married men is that they hardly have sex with their wives. I love my girl and all, but why get married if it's going to change what we already have going on?
So they already have sex? Is that what we're to assume?
I mean,
that's what...
You should cut it off now.
that's what he's saying. Go ahead.
Sheila's hand is up with a major fornicator. Major.
Go ahead.
Major. Like my husband and I, he met me. I think that's why. Anyway, sorry. So, so I have a different. I don't know. I talk to a lot of married women in my circle and my group of friends. I was married once anyway, and I kind of always am the standout person in the group of friends because I'm always saying stuff, and married women look at me like I'm crazy. So I do tend to think that a lot of married couples don't have as much sex as they did if they were having sex prior to marriage, or as much as their husbands thought they would once they get married. I have a difference of opinion because I am the one who's always pursuing my husband. That's just me.
And you ain't alone.
I'm chasing the orgasm all the time. You don't even have to. Like, thank you. You could just, we're not going to get graphic, but, you know, I just love the orgasm. And women can't understand that. Like, it's not for him. Sex is not for him. Sex is for me. He just wins by, you know, default. So,
yes.
I think that, however, let me talk about married people. Married people, when they go through negative things in their life, they tend to be way boisterous. And then when they're in a group with a couple of young men or young women who are engaged and loving life because they have this new significant other that's possibly going to be their wife or their husband, we tend to spew our negativity. And now he's thinking, oh my gosh, I'm not going to have sex with my wife. Not true. Then another thing we got to look at is that men and women peak at different levels in their relationship.
Right.
I mean, in their life. You know, women peak a little later on, men peak a little younger, and it kind of fluctuates. But, you know, I think if you have open communication and you're open about sex and free like me, you know, things tend to be a little different, of course. You know, me and my husband, you know, I said this in our couples ministry the other day, is that I have a... When you're going through negative things in your life, because me and my husband, we almost separated. So when we went through negative things, of course it was a downward spiral, which was so frustrating for me. But we are in a place right now that, you know, he just got to look at me funny. And I say to people that sex can be therapeutic in relationships. It so can. I think that when you're intimate with your partner, that you can see them differently. You have more compassion in terms of when you're disagreeing and you want to have an open communication. It opens that line. You're not tense. The orgasm is so relaxing. You know, that's just my opinion.
Yeah.
No, this is Kwani. I want to interject here, too. So my concern with this question is, in what scenarios is he having this conversation? And who is he speaking to? You always have to consider the source. I mean, always have to consider the source. Mm-hmm. Because if you're speaking to an unhappily married man...
That's right.
That conversation about sex is going to be completely different...
Yes.
...than if you're speaking to a man who is happily married.
Right.
And those scenarios are completely different for those two men. And it makes me wonder, like, who's actually getting the airtime in this man's ear?
Right.
You know, is he just going to a group of his buddies and, you know, they're not really serious about their marriage? Or is he going to, like, a man that is solid in his marriage, that is covering his wife in his marriage, that is taking care of that gift that he has in his marriage? Because it's not going to be the same conversation.
Right.
Absolutely not.
Yeah.
And that's my question. Who is he talking to? Who's putting that bell in his ear? And who's driving that conversation?
You know, and it's interesting because last week...
This is Paula. I think also you have to take consideration. If you're having that much thought about marriage, then you shouldn't be getting married no way.
Hey!
If you're asking people to affirm your decision... Without asking God to affirm your decision.
Yes.
Then you're asking the wrong people.
Yes.
There comes a point where you have to man up and say, God, is this person for me or is this person not for me? Your friends and your relatives and your church members don't know that.
Right.
Only God knows that.
Right.
So I think sometimes we have to watch who we get advice from.
That's right.
And not necessarily go to some people because... Only God can tell me. I, at the point where I got divorced, I told my friends and family, I'm not getting married again. I'm through. I've already been through that one time. Obviously, I'm a disaster. I'm not getting married again.
Yeah.
And 3 years later, here I was getting married again.
Yeah.
But I didn't go to my friends and family and say, well, do you think I should marry Riddell? No. I prayed about it. I asked God about it. Because God knows him, God knows me, God knows our future, he knows our past. So there was no reason for me to have a conversation with Joe Schmo when Joe Schmo got more problems than I do.
Right. And you know what? When we discussed this with the males said that this was a lie from the pit of hell. If you are happily married, then this is not an issue. And they were unanimous with that, saying that this is not an issue. And so the person that... they were going, this person was going to speak to get advice on what should I do. They were talking to the wrong people. And then I added, this is me now. This is Landy adding this. If it seems like as if though this person who is asking the wrong people is looking for an out because he doesn't have the courage to say, I don't want to do this myself. He's looking for reasons from the people who will give him the bad and negative reasons to step out of it because he doesn't have the courage to say it himself that I am not ready. Dude, if you're 32 years old and you asking folks talking about, I don't know if I'm going to get married because I'm not going to have sex, and marriage ain't all about sex, and you asking those questions, amen, you are not ready. Leave it alone and don't waste that girl's time. That's all I'm saying.
Right. I agree. And it also made me, this is Kwame, it also made me think about what is his motivation? So is your motivation in marriage to get a pass to have guilt-free sex?
Wow.
That's clearly not a good enough reason to get married.
Right.
You know, so it's like when you think about people's motivations to get married, you think about, okay, so, you know, are you psychologically ready? Are you, you know, ready for the financial piece that comes with marriage? Like, there are things that you should be well aware of before you get married. And yes, sex is a very important part of that. But if your motivation is wrong, then you already started on the wrong foot.
Yes.
And like exactly. You said, you will find people that will, you know, you'll find out of a group of men that you talk to for this particular person, out of a group of men, you'll find that out of the five people, you have four people saying, oh, yeah, man, you know, it doesn't happen. And then the one person that is happy gets drowned out by all of that other nonsense.
Yes.
You know, so it's just like, are you really asking because you want to know the answer? Or are you really asking, like you said, to just find a way out? And that makes me question his motivation.
Yes. Totally.
Yeah, Brian, that's funny. You've also got to look at the fact that if they have all this sex now, and I think with Paula, who was talking about, did he ask God if this is the one for him? Did he? Because if they're having all this sex now, he's clouded.
Yeah.
That's right.
I was going to say the same thing, Sheila. This is Crystal. What caught me in the whole question was, like, why would I get married if we handling our business or if we're happy now? And I thought to myself, you know what? This woman needs to cut him off.
Yeah.
She needs to separate and let him fast and pray.
Yeah.
Because I guarantee when he knows how much he loves her, that sex is going to come and it's going to go. It may be thrusting like rabbits one year. Mm-hmm. It may be slow. Mm-hmm. It may be like a snail one next year. It all depends on how hard it is and how close you guys are.
Yeah.
But let me tell you something. If you are in a sexual relationship with this person, and he hasn't made a full commitment to you yet, and you are offering your best and doing tricks and doing whatever.
Yeah.
Girl, the cheer-up is real.
She said I'm tricks.
What it was from the beginning. And you got to always bring it. So don't forget yourself. The reality of it all is, wherever you start up with, you only should go higher.
Yeah.
You're going to go down because you didn't set the standard too high.
Yeah.
That's right.
Listen, you ain't saying nothing, girl. I'm still trying to come up with new tricks.
I know, that's right.
Yeah, but see, the problem is, you started the tricks before you got married.
So what?
You gonna do? I stayed in the stores and I stayed online, girl.
I think that sometimes we can't. You can't have a meeting of the booty before and think that you're going to be able to make clear decisions. You should not.
Yes.
That's why I wish that I didn't have sex before I got married. I wish, I really do. I had had prior to before I got married, and then when I got married, I'm like, dude, this ain't nothing.
Yeah.
I shouldn't have known that.
Yeah.
That was a big problem in my first marriage. I shouldn't have had the knowledge I had, but clearly I did. And when you know, and then you go back to, you marry somebody, because I tried to do the right thing. I was a good girl. I decided, okay, well, we're going to get married and we're not going to have sex. I didn't have sex with my first husband before I got married. Had I had sex with him before I got married, I would have never married him.
Wow.
Put it, say it.
That's right. That's right.
That's the truth. Let me tell you something. Let me tell you something else. Now, I did have sex before marriage, and my thing with that was, I was saying to myself, okay, we know it's wrong, but the enticement of it, the secrecy, that just brought it to the next level.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not saying it's right, but I'm saying when you start off doing something sneaky, you got to keep pretending, and that sneakiness does bring it to something else. So now it's open, it's all you can have, and it's not always as good. Sometimes it's a quickie, sometimes it's in the sometimes it's in the back. I mean, you got to really try to make that first secret, oh, let's sneak here thing every time.
Yeah.
It got to the point, we've been married for 17 years. I'll just be like, can you stop looking at me? Even one look, he going to jump on you. So you got to, like, get your mind right.
I love Crystal.
Before, you never had to say, it's going to happen. It just happened. Now you got to be like, oh, Lord, give me 10 minutes.
Yes.
I'll be right back.
Yes.
Oh, no. I'm with it. I'm with it all day.
I mean, literally, you were with it all. I mean, when you were with it all day, yeah. Prior, you put some miles on it. You put
Let me tell you, my husband and I, of course, we've been together for 15 years this year. We've been married for going on 11, but we've been together for 15 years, and that was 20 years ago. And so I didn't have the upbringing. But, of course, my mother had this speech with me when I was young about that. She was like, you know, my mother had the little, I was raised by a single mother, so it was always open communication, open lines. You know, sex is great, she was, you want to make sure that you have to be married first, but when she saw that I had sex, it was a real calm. She never treated me, and she was never angry. She was never, you know, upset, hurt, disappointed. She was like, okay, babe, this is what we're going to do. We're going to go to a doctor, we're going to do that. So I had a decent... And the guy that my ex was, I was with him for 7 years. So, and I chose to leave him. He was so disappointed, but I ended up being with my husband right after. So I had two long-term relationships. It wasn't like, you know, I had this catastrophe of a introduction to sexuality. So I embraced my sexuality with my husband. He was kind of like, who are you? Who did this tornado my way? You know, what is this? What are you introducing me to? What is happening? And so he embraced it, well, he had to anyway, right? And I still have the same mentality. Like, I still have, okay, let's try this. Let me go order this online. Let me look at this gel. Let me look at that. Let me look at that. And he's
right.
Like, okay. Okay, I'm always chasing something new. I'm the chaser. My husband, he's just like, okay, I'm along for the ride.
Yeah.
Well, nothing's wrong with that. Maybe this guy who wrote in really needs to listen to this women's show,
yeah,
and feel what he is missing and what he will miss if he don't jump on the right bandwagon.
Right,
he may not get it for the rest of his life. Single people don't get sex every day,
right,
or every week.
That's true.
Right.
I got friends who are in drought, begging to have sex.
I can't.
Drought.
It's hard for a single. It's hard for single women. I'm not kidding.
Yeah.
If you ain't locked down by a certain age. It gets harder. The pickings get slim, and I would not want to be in a drought like that.
Yeah, I
couldn't imagine.
I think what's important for the person, I think what's important for the person that wrote this letter is that if he is seriously considering marriage, then he really needs to pay attention to who he has around him and who has his ear, who is speaking in to him. Because if he is speaking to other married men who appear to be unhappy and who don't want to be in their marriage, then he can pretty much bet and believe that that's going to be his position after he gets married. So if he really wants to be married, be successfully married, then first of all, he needs to pray and he needs to ask God to send the right people to speak to him. Because I've witnessed other married people tell other married people, oh no, it's too much, it's this, don't do it, this and that, or you know, I don't know why I did this or whatever. Honey, keep that to yourself. I mean, keep that to yourself and handle that, because I don't want that around my space. You know what I mean? And so as a result of that, Now you're sowing this unhappiness and this discontentment to other people, and now you're making it seem like as if though, okay, well, yeah, they so-and-so have problems, so yeah, that means I got problems too. Nah, y'all live it day by day, seek to do the best, be the best, enjoy the best of your spouse, and make sure that whoever you have around you, that they too are trying to do the best for their marriage. This brother right here, Mr. 32-year-old, trying to figure out if you want to be married or not, I encourage you to find the right people to speak to you. You do not want to go into this. Right. You do not want to go.
Girlfriend, y'all better tell her.
That's why. You do not want to go into this marriage unhappy and with low expectations. Marriage is truly a gift from God. It is a challenge, but it makes you grow. It makes you grow. And it is such an incredible blessing when you seek God before going into it. So please, if you're unsure, then be real with yourself. But if you are sure, then make sure to surround yourself with the right people. All right? Ladies, we have 4 more minutes left in the show. I'm not going to get to the last question. I think that this question was a good place to end. Do you guys have anything in closing that you want to say before I play our inspirational video? We good?
I wanted to just say, I think marriage is, it can be a beautiful thing when God blesses you with the right person at the right time. I want to stress to people not to stress themselves out if it hasn't happened for them. Right. I think a lot of times we as women, we settle sometimes because we think, oh, this ain't going to get no better. Let me just don't get married.
Yeah.
And I don't want people to believe that God doesn't have a plan for their lives.
Right.
I truly believe that God has a plan for each person. And marriage is not for everybody.
Right.
There's some people who are never going to be married. So I think it's having an honest and open conversation with yourself and really pouring your heart out to God and saying, listen, I need to know what you want from me. And then going forward with that. I don't think it's for everybody. I enjoy marriage. I love being married. I love my husband. I adore him. But I also recognize that I have girlfriends who may never have that. Yeah. And I still love them. We still good. But I don't look down on other people because they aren't married, and right. They don't look down on me because I am.
Right.
I think we need to be honest and learn to love people who wherever they are.
Right.
And let God lead. I think when we try to lead ourselves, I have a basic lesson about being hard-headed. And sometimes we are hard-headed. We try to do what we want to do and not what God wants us to do.
Yeah. So that's just
my take on.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is a hard lesson.
Yeah. No, I definitely agree. I think that we need to seek God's plan for our life and not seek what we think we want. And it's hard sometimes. It's hard to make the it's hard to make the adjustment from what I think I want, what I think is best for me, to God's plan. Which may be really to help improve our character, build us as a person, and get us to the kingdom. So, you know, it's that journey in life. And I don't want anyone to feel discouraged because things aren't happening the way that they want them to happen. But rather be encouraged and know that God has a plan for your life. And so take your time and take every effort. Make every effort to find out what that is so you can walk in it and experience life that will blow your mind, regardless of what that looks like. Married, single, whatever. Regardless of what that looks like, experience life that will blow your mind. Ladies, you know, I thank you so very much for joining me this evening. Miss Paula, Sheila, Crystal, Kwani. Thanks to Ayinde and Rufus for joining as well earlier on in the show to come back and do some follow-up questions. You know, the reason why, and I, like I always say, LaLa Speakx is not a relationship. I'm not a relationship coach. I am not a spiritual coach. I am not any of those coaches. I am a life coach. I am a personal advancement coach. And I do that because all these things that we encounter in life, that can help harm us in terms of actually reaching our goals and living life abundantly. We oftentimes cannot achieve where we need to be because we are so busy living in shame. We are so busy living in the secrecy of what I did yesterday and not forgiving ourselves, and then turning around to be the better version of ourselves the next day and the next day and the next day. And so the reason why I decided to tackle the healthy sexuality topic is because a lot of us in the church, we don't get the real conversation as it relates to sex. We are told not to do it. We're told that it's dirty, and it's just the opposite. God created it to be beautiful within the correct parameters. And a lot of times we step outside the parameters, and therefore we experience the ugly that sin brings to sex. And so because we don't do a good job in the walls of the church actually teaching about healthy sexuality and the sexuality that God wants us to experience as is written in his word, because we don't do a lot of that and we look at it as something that is dirty, we therefore create a topic that is now taboo. And when we create a topic that is taboo, we don't talk about it. And then you have people in corners doing all kinds of foolishness because they're not talking about it and they're living in shame. And so the reason why I decided to highlight healthy sexuality within the church this entire series is because I've been getting a lot of letters about it. And I realized that when you give airtime to something that has held you captive, then it can no longer hold you captive because you have now given it, you have now shed a light on it. And so the purpose is to shed a light on those dark areas that create shame, on those dark areas that stop us from reaching our fullest potential. And so as we continue to do this, I am encouraging you to be real with yourself, understand what makes you tick, understand your urges, and then seek God for those things. Now, there's a second show that everyone is trying to get me to do. This show about being single and horny and, you know, and stuff. I have no problem doing it, but what I'm saying is I can't do it because I'm not single and I'm not horny. So, so what I want to do is I can provide this platform for any single person that wants to have a real conversation. This platform is for real conversations. If you want to have a real conversation about it, then I encourage you to send me an email, landy@lalaspeakx.com, landi@lalaspeakx.com. I will not have that show if you guys don't email me. Everyone is talking about, oh, we need to have this talk, we need to do this and all this stuff or whatever, but you got to be ready to have that conversation. So if you want to have that conversation, a real conversation, and then I will bring someone on the show to help us talk solutions as it relates to it, email me, landi@lalaspeakx.com. Or if you want to send in a situation anonymously, you can go to lalaspeakx.com, click on online show, and you can submit it right there. But if you want to go ahead and have that conversation, you must email me, okay? And then that will be the fourth and final installment for healthy sexuality within the church. We're dealing with the singles. So if you want that topic, you got to email me. Guys, I appreciate you guys for joining this evening, for everything in the chat room that was taking place. I appreciate you. The rebroadcast is going to be up on my webpage tomorrow, lalaspeakx.com. Share it. If you know anyone that needs to hear some of the topics that we talked about tonight, definitely share it. I want to thank Paula, Sheila, Crystal, and Kwani for their honesty, their openness, and for having this conversation. As always, I will leave you with an inspirational video because life can be hard, but we have the tools to make it through. All right? This is Landy of LaLa Speakx. Later. Bye.
Life isn't over. Never let your struggle make you think that. I know your setbacks were major, but so can be your comeback. You see, strength, pain builds that. I know it might be hard for you to feel that, But even in your darkest storms, there's a plan for you to still shine bright. Please believe that. I know because God did it for me. God will allow you to go through places you don't understand just to bring you to the place where He needs you to be. So don't let this see. Life isn't over. Never let your struggle make you think that. I know your setbacks were major, but so can be your comeback. You see, strength, pain builds that. I know it might be hard for you to feel that, but even in your darkest storms, there's a plan for you to still shine bright. Please believe that. I know because God did it for me. God will allow you to go through places you don't understand just to bring you to the place where He needs you to be. So don't let this season take your life. You can win this fight. If it wasn't for my darkest moments, I would have never found the strength to shine my light. There's a purpose greater than your pain. There's no growth without rain. Sometimes it takes our hardest storms to birth our greatest change. Your life is not finished. You keep living. It doesn't matter what happened in your past. You're just a choice away from a new beginning. There's more to be written. Your perspective can either be your power or your prison. So no matter what, appreciate your life and build your testimony with the test you were given. Listen, I get it. I know depression is real, but so is deliverance. You can heal from those afflictions, overcome those addictions. It's time to put a semicolon when you're trying to put a period because your sentence hasn't ended. You got more life to live, so don't give up. And forget anything or anybody that's ever tried to make you feel like you're not enough. You're enough. You're more than enough. So don't try to end your story just because this chapter sucks. Breakdowns happen right before breakthroughs. So I pray you break that cycle that's trying to break you. I pray you keep those thoughts that are trying to kill you. No mistake is too great as long as you forgive you. Make your tomorrow new. You always have a choice. Never stay silent about your battles. Give your pain a voice. It's okay to not be okay. We're all one struggle away. Your change is gonna come. You just keep believing day by day. This storm will eventually run out of rain. And remember, we are all a little broken. But the last time I checked, broken crayons still color the same. You go defeat your pain. Your life is not.
LaLa Speakx is about owning who you are. LaLa Speakx is about loving who you are. LaLa Speakx is about embracing who you are and allowing all those things to move you forward towards action.
LaLa. Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. And even if I get frustrated and I don't want to talk to the Lord, you know what? He still speaks. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak. She talking about what's right in the world and what goes wrong to make your spirit unfurl. Hold on. Now that's
speak
deep.
To the glasses, let them hear what you think. To the thirsty, let your words be a drink. LaLa, speak to one with the voice of community. Lend your gifts to help restore unity. LaLa, speak to the masses, let them hear what you think. To the thirsty, let your words be a drink. LaLa, speak to one with the voice of community. Lend your gifts to help restore unity.
Every first Monday at 9 p.m. Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. And even if I get frustrated and I don't want to talk to the Lord, you know what? He still speaks. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak. She talking about what's right in the world and what goes wrong to make your spirit unfurl. Now that's deep. Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak.
I am a life coach. I am a motivational speaker. I am a wife and a mother and a career woman. I'm all those things. Why? Because I can.
Hold on.
LaLa Speakx is about owning who you are. LaLa Speakx is about loving who you are. LaLa Speakx is about embracing who you are and allowing all those things to move you forward towards action.
LaLa.
Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. And even if I get frustrated and I don't want to talk to the Lord, you know what? He still speaks. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak. She talking about what's right in the world and what goes wrong to make your spirit unfurl. Hold up. Now that's
speak deep. To the masses, let them hear what you think. To the thirsty, let your words be a drink. LaLa speaks to one with the voice of community. Lend your gifts to help restore unity. LaLa speaks to the masses, let them hear what you think. To the thirsty, let your words be a drink. LaLa speaks to one with the voice of community. Lend your gifts to help restore unity.
Every first Monday at 9 p.m. Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. And even if I get frustrated and I don't want to talk to the Lord, you know what? He still speaks. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak. She talking about what's right in the world and what goes wrong to make your spirit unfurl.
Hold on.
Now that's deep. Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my voice couldn't be heard, I still speak. So now I'm just riding around in my Jeep, but I'm still tuned in to hear LaLa speak.
I am a life coach. I am a motivational speaker. I am a wife and a mother and a career woman. I'm all those things. Why? Because I can.
Hold up.
LaLa Speakx is about owning who you are. LaLa Speakx is about loving who you are. LaLa Speakx is about embracing who you are and allowing all those things to move you forward towards action.
LaLa.
Every time I wake in the morning, I think, even if my